are you wise? I don't mean are you a wise guy, and forgive me if I've used this line before. Sometimes I cannot remember what we have done in Sunday school versus what I have said here in the pulpit. So if I say the same things over again, and you notice, well, good for you, because you've been paying attention. Anyhow, so are you wise? Does somebody think that you are a wise guy? Are you able to analyze a situation and impart wisdom that is going to improve on that situation? Can you look at some thing that is unfolding or some situation that somebody is facing in life or some difficulty that they're having, and you are able to give them wisdom to help move them through that situation that they're facing? That is a type of wisdom, but there are all sorts of wisdom out there in the world, such as, can you discern how to wisely invest or spend money? Some people are really wise when it comes to finances. Or are you wise in being able to administer things, plan events, or to run a business, or do all the logistical things that to me are an absolute nightmare? Do you have that sort of wisdom? Or do you have maybe godly wisdom that you put into practice in your life, and as a result, the way that you live honors God? Now, wisdom is not something that is easily learned. In fact, many times wisdom is generated because of stupid mistakes we make when we're younger, or maybe older. Stupid mistakes that we make, and then we learn from them, and we gain wisdom through those, or gain wisdom through life experience. Some people are naturally wise, that they can you can be talking with them and they can just spew forth wisdom, and you're like, this is awesome, can you run my life for me? But some people they learn it, but some people, like maybe me, wisdom never comes. It is great to have wisdom. The business world will hire somebody who is wise and capable of pouring forth wisdom in a heartbeat. It is a very valuable quality to have. But it's not just important to have wisdom. It is important to have the right kind of wisdom. For example, you can have all sorts of wisdom. Say if you live in a very large metropolitan area, you can have all sorts of wisdom called street smarts about how to live and survive in an environment that is a lot more different than rural society. Say for example, well, it doesn't necessarily have to be in a city. Street smarts can really happen anywhere. But say, for example, you're talking with your buddies, and you're expressing your frustration or your hatred at this dude because he has insulted your family. Nobody insults my family but me, right? And so you're saying that, and your friends are like, dude, that is so horrible. Why are they talking about your family like that? You know what you ought to do? Next time they talk about your family, just punch them in the face. That'll teach them. That'll shut them up. And so the next time you're mouthing off, they're mouthing off about your family, you smack them in the face, and guess what? You get in a fight, you get arrested, bad things happen. But that is street smarts, and really that is like macho street wisdom. Okay, you don't talk about my family, you don't talk about my mama. When I was a kid, we used to tell mama jokes, but it was, you know, something we laughed at, but well, when he actually said it to somebody seriously, it was the most offensive thing in the world, but everybody knows it's just a joke. Come on, dude. But, you know, macho street wisdom says that if you are insulted, you strike back. You slap him, you get in an altercation, you defend somebody's honor, which some of that is good and some of it is bad. But if you are not careful, it will land you in jail. Right? So maybe macho street wisdom isn't the best kind of wisdom, especially if you are a follower of Jesus and you want to live out the teachings where Jesus says, as far as it is concerned with you, make peace or be at peace with everybody. Get along. And guess what? By the love that you show to one another, people are going to know you're my followers. You know, if you're going to live that, having street smarts and this macho mentality is not going to get you to that goal. You have to have the right kind of wisdom. And if you do not have the wisdom that comes from God, then you're going to have wisdom that doesn't cut the mustard or doesn't get you to where you need to be. But if you have wisdom that is merely human, and you rely on that wisdom, and you don't listen to the wisdom of God, eventually you are going to conclude that wisdom from God seems absolutely foolish. The wisdom from the world is going to lead you to conclude that this whole thing about God, about Jesus, about the church, about self-sacrifice, about serving other people, this whole deal about the cross, the Bible, all of it is just stupidity. It is foolish, and only fools entertain thoughts about these things. And I guarantee that sometime in our lives, we are going to encounter people who think that about us because they live according to wisdom that does not come from God. And so when they look at us, they think that we are a bunch of morons. We're fools. We're idiots because we follow Jesus and his teachings. And so this year, one of our goals is for each family to bring somebody new into our fellowship. And that is going to require that we talk to people about Jesus. And if they do not already follow Jesus, they might think that what you're talking about is just stupid. It is foolish. It doesn't get you ahead in life. It doesn't get you to the things that you really want in this life. It doesn't give you the pleasure and the happiness and the temporary fun that you get from living like the world. And so when you start talking about the cross, you start talking about what Jesus did on the cross, they're going to think that is absolutely ridiculous. And this is very much the situation that the church in Corinth was facing. If you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn over to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. We're going to begin at verse 18. But this is exactly the sort of mindset that Christians in the early days of the church were facing. That people looked at them and they thought that the message that they were proclaiming and living by was pure nonsense. And so by looking at this, I hope that we can learn a thing or two about God's wisdom. Or what the world thinks is foolish, maybe we can find something about true wisdom from that. Now, before we get into the text today in verse 18, I want us to consider momentarily what Paul said in the previous verse in this letter. The last thing that he said is that when he preached the gospel to the church in Corinth, he did not use words of eloquent wisdom so that the cross would not be emptied of its power. He didn't come using earthly wisdom or earthly tactics. He didn't come with flashy style or great fancy arguments to win them to Jesus because he did not want to cancel out the saving power of the cross. And so he's going to go in from this point forward and talk about the power of the cross and the foolishness of the cross. So let's go ahead and dive in and see what he says about here, about wisdom and the cross and all that. He says, "For the word of the cross is folly. It is foolishness to those who are perishing. But to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has God not made foolish the wisdom of the world?" So he begins by reminding us that the message of the cross does not align with the wisdom of the world. We're at odds. We contradict the wisdom of the world. And so that is going to put us in conflict. And so they think that the gospel, that the cross, that what Jesus did on the cross is foolish because it violates everything that they think and the way they think and how they believe. And we're going to get into that here in a few moments. But he contrasts that by saying, yes, they look at the cross and they see it as foolish. They see it as stupid. They see it as unnecessary. But those who are being saved, we recognize that it is the power of God, that God saves us through this foolish message of the cross. So what the world sees as stupid and powerless and ridiculous, we see it as great power. And then he goes on to say that God has used the cross, he's used the gospel, he's used the teaching of Jesus to show that those people in the world who think that they are something, that they think they are wise and intelligent, that really they're nothing. They amount to diddly squat. He uses this old path, this scripture from the Old Testament to talk about how God had promised, look, I am going to, one day in the future, I'm going to make all these smart people look dumb. They think that they are high and mighty, that they are so lofty that they can live in their ivory tower and not be touched. Watch this. I am going to humble them and show that my wisdom is the true wisdom. And then he says rhetorically, where are all these different people? These are the people that they looked up to, the elite people, the educated people, the smart people that they would have looked up to for wisdom and knowledge and understanding about all matters of life. And he says, where are they to be found? Now, they could tell you where these people were. Maybe they where they lived, where they taught. Yeah, if you want to know wisdom, you go to this temple. If you want to learn about some teachings about this, you go to that temple. They know where these people were. But it is a rhetorical device to say, look, these guys, they amount to nothing. The philosopher that you think that is highly educated? No. Or the teacher of the law, that they might be able to tell you all about the Old Testament? Yeah, they don't really know about God. They just know about the law. Or that great debater who is really good at convincing people, he misses it. He's wrong. But because of what God has accomplished through Jesus, all of these people that we look up to in God's eyes are as dumb as a box of rocks because they don't have the true wisdom from God. And what is so ironic about all of this, what is really, it's comedy, it's funny to God that he would choose something that the world sees as stupid and foolish to save the world. It's something that the world looks at and laughs at and scoffs at and say, that is ridiculous, that God chooses that very thing to save the world. And so we see that the foolish cross is perfect wisdom because it reveals the power of God. And we see this even in the life of Jesus. As he is going around teaching, preaching, and healing, we see that he exercises power over demons. He exercises power over sickness, over nature, over political power, over any sort of human weakness. That Jesus shows that he is in control of all of it. And in Jesus' death, we see his power over sin, that he can take and he can conquer sin where we were powerless to do anything about it before. And in the resurrection of Jesus, we see that God has power even over death, even if we are in the grave for 3 days or a week or a month or for 2,000 years, that God can still raise us back to life. And then through the story of Jesus, through the Old Testament, into the New Testament, we see God exercising even power over himself, where he exercises power over his wrath and his judgment to give us time to repent and turn to Jesus. And so if we have accepted the gospel, we are experiencing his power. Now he says this is a present reality that we are experiencing the power of God in our lives. It's not just something that happened in the past when God took away our sin. It's not just something that we're going to experience in the future when Jesus returns and raises us all back to life. But this is something that we are experiencing every single day of our lives because we have God dwelling with us. And so God shows us that he has power over our past and our sins and our struggles. He has power to help us through the worst days of our lives. He has power. He gives us power to live the way that God calls us to live. When he says, look, this is how you are to teach. And by the way, be perfect as my heavenly Father is perfect. He doesn't just say, okay, go out and do it on your own, because we have failed miserably year after year to do that. But he gives us the power to actually live how he calls us to live. He gives us power over addictions. He gives us power over selfishness. He gives us power over whatever things might be getting in the way of us and him. So in the cross, we see what the world sees as foolish. We see it as wise, because we see the power of God demonstrated. But he goes on to contrast and compare the wisdom of the world with the wisdom of God. He goes on to say, for since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, it pleased God through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe. The problem with wisdom, whether it's Jewish wisdom or whether it's Gentile wisdom, whether it's Roman wisdom or Greek wisdom, is that it cannot lead us to God. And what is interesting about that is even ancient Greek philosophers before the time of Jesus acknowledged that wisdom cannot lead them to a full knowledge of God. And so many philosophers from the old days said, hey, look, we've got to worship God. And especially Jewish philosophers, they said, look, we cannot come to God on our own. We've got to let God come to us. We've got to let God reveal himself to us. And so in our human wisdom, even though we can do so many things, we cannot bring ourselves to a knowledge of God. It cannot happen, even though God gives us evidence all over the place that because of our twisted thinking, because of our selfishness and our sin, that we always end up inventing a God of our own design that has our own weaknesses, our own failures and failings. When you look at all the gods that they made up in the times of the Greeks and the Romans and various cultures around, all the gods that they invented had the same human weaknesses, because they're all made in our own image, through our own philosophy and our own minds. But since we cannot come up with knowledge and wisdom about who God is on our own, what we see through the cross is that God stepped in and revealed himself to us. Now, we knew of him at the beginning when God created Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve, walked with God in the garden. And all throughout history, God has revealed himself over and over again, literally to people walking on this earth. So it's not like we have, God created us and set us here and ignored us since the creation. But he has been actively involved. But even then, we have distorted and we have come to dissuade ourselves away from God because of our own wisdom. But God steps in through the person of Jesus to help us understand who he is, what he is, how he loves us, and how he intends to save us. And so, when God did step in to show us the way of salvation, he did it in a way that none of us expected. The Jews expected someone completely different than Jesus. They expected the end result of his ministry to be something completely different. The Greeks, they looked for all sorts of things. So Jesus was not who they expected. And so God took something unexpected and foolish in order to save us. And so what Paul here is getting at is that the foolish cross is perfect wisdom because it reminds us of our limitations. That we cannot know God through our own philosophy and our own way of thinking. Now, if you think about it, humans are incredibly smart and wise. We have the ability, it is unfathomable to me, that we can look at a microscope and we can take a picture of an electron. You know, these things that are spinning around so quickly, or at least take a picture of an individual atom with an electron microscope. We can take a picture of an individual atom, and we can take on a piece of a metal, whatever, we can arrange single atoms to write out a word like IBM or some other word. That is awesome intelligence. Or we can build this huge circle and we can fling different atoms at each other and explode them. And then we can detect like little tiny little bits and pieces of atoms and electrons and protons and all these things that break apart and shatter. We can detect them for fractions upon fractions upon fractions of a second. These things that, they are gone before we even realize what has happened. That we can detect these things. Or what is unfathomable to me is that we can send a robot over 100 million miles away to land on a planet, to drive around and obey our commands from 100 million miles away, 180 million miles away. We can land a robot on Mars and tell it, drill here, pull out the sample, put it in the spectrum analyzer and tell us what's in there. And then it says, and it sends all the information back to Earth, 100 million miles away. And we have trouble with our cell phone reception. Okay? But we are not dumb. And when you think about people even in Jesus' day and before Jesus, we understood complex algebra and geometry. Some of the people who invented geometry, which we hate, they lived before Jesus. They had people computing the circumference of the earth, realizing the earth was round, trying to calculate the circumference of the earth. Hundreds of years before Jesus, people are not stupid. If you can have these pyramids built with these huge blocks with slave labor, and it is almost so precise that there are barely any variations in measurements, we are not stupid. We are incredibly intelligent and wise. And yet, and we have endless access to unlimited knowledge. We can know anything, anytime, anywhere. Like, hey Siri, what is the circumference of the earth? And we don't have to wait. She tells me that the earth is 24,901 miles in circumference. We don't have to sit down with pen and paper and think about it. It is instant. And yet, we cannot open a portal to beam ourselves into heaven. We can't eradicate evil from this world. No matter how many laws we pass, no matter how many criminals we lock up, or no matter how many dictators we depose or terrorists we destroy with drones, we cannot eradicate evil from the world. We can't remove the consequences of sin from the world. No matter how hard we try, we cannot get rid of these things. We are absolutely limited. So we've got to recognize that we can't do everything. We can't fix our own problems. We need Jesus to help us. We need God to show us the way of salvation. We need God to show us how to live wisely in this crazy, messed up world. And yeah, the world looks at us and they think that we are foolish and dumb for admitting that we need Jesus. But it is in our foolish trusting of Jesus that we find salvation through Him. So Paul he's given us the assertion. He's told us that people of the world, they look at the cross and they think it is stupid. They think it is moronic. And he goes on to explain to us why. In verse 22, he says, "For Jews demand signs, and Greeks seek wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and a folly to Gentiles. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men." So here is why people had a hard time understanding Jesus. And it really boils down to this, that He did not fit into their way of thinking. That the Jews, they demanded signs of Jesus. And you can see this in Jesus' ministry. When He was going around doing awesome things, performing miracles, people still bugged Him. "Hey, Jesus, show us a sign." He was going around healing people, telling the wind and the waves to stop, and they stopped. He was raising people from the dead. He was dividing up a few loaves and fishes to feed like 5,000 to 10,000 people. And they come up to Him, "Jesus, show us a sign." "Hello? Have you been not wearing your glasses? Because look at this. I mean, even in the context, in one particular passage in Matthew, Jesus heals this guy who had a withered hand. He had some birth defect or something wrong with his hand, and Jesus heals him. And he's healed. And he's going around and healing all sorts of people of their diseases. And then there's this guy who comes up and he's got this demon possession. He can't speak or hear. And Jesus casts the demon out. Immediately he's healed. And then it is after that where they say, okay, Jesus, show us a sign. I just cast out a demon, dummy. But what they were looking for is they were looking for something even more spectacular. They were looking for a guy like Moses who was going to come and lead them out of bondage. They were looking for a new Exodus, and they were looking for somebody to do it. So the sign that they're really asking from Jesus, show us a sign, is overthrow the Roman occupation. That is what we want you to do. Go do it. If you are really the Messiah, kick out the Roman army. Kick out Herod's descendants. Kick out Pilate. That is what they wanted. But that's not what Jesus gave them. And then the Greeks are wanting wisdom. They wanted to make sure that they had all sorts of whatever the new philosophy is. They wanted to learn it. They wanted to know it. They wanted to build on their body of knowledge, especially so that maybe if there was a god that they didn't know about or some wisdom that they were ignorant of, they didn't want to offend the gods or they didn't want to live in a way that was stupid. So they're always wanting to learn new things. And so in the book of Acts, we see Paul is in the city of Athens, and he's teaching in a synagogue, and some philosophers are there, and they're like, hey, dude, you're teaching this new philosophy. We love philosophy. Come and talk to us about this. Come to the Areopagus, and we'll talk about this new philosophy that you have about this thing called Jesus. And so Paul goes, and he begins to explain to them the good news of Jesus. And then he gets to the parts where he mentions the cross, and he starts talking about the resurrection. Whoa! No resurrection! No resurrection! Get out of here! We don't want to hear. And so some of the people who were there start making fun of him. Now, some people believe, but there were some guys there making fun of him, calling him names, you idiot. Nobody can come back from the dead. What are you? And so that is what we see is the message of the cross, the resurrection, is ridiculous. And even from a Jewish and Greek perspective, it was foolish that somebody would choose to die a criminal's death on a cross when they had done nothing wrong. To them, that was the worst thing that was possible. And even for the Greeks, for them, for a God to take on flesh like they taught Jesus was, for God to take on flesh, that is perhaps the worst thing you could even imagine. Now, sometimes gods would come down to earth and mate with humans. That was okay. But for a God to take on this nasty flesh, I mean, that is defiling. That is the worst thing a God could do. No way a God would do that. And so everything about the cross did not fit into their way of thinking. And it's very similar today, that the message of Jesus does not fit in the way the people's world think. It is contrary to the wisdom of the day, where people, first of all, expect everything to be perfectly rational, even though we do not hold to that ourselves. Okay, God has to be logical. God has to be proven and confirmed by science. There's no way that Jesus could do miracles because that would violate the laws of nature. Jesus has to fit in with the latest political philosophy. It has to fit in with what our culture thinks is right or wrong or honorable or not. And if Jesus goes against the current of culture, then he's just an idiot. And we're idiots for following him. So in all of their seeking, the Jews and the Gentiles, the Greeks and the Romans, could never find what they were looking for. That reminds me of a U2 song. You still haven't found what you're looking for. Or is it, I still haven't found what I'm looking for. I don't know. They still hadn't found what they're looking for. But the same pattern repeats over and over. Humans, we are stupid. We repeat our mistakes over and over again. We still, when we try to find life, or we're trying to find God, we try to find a religion, we try to find a wise way to live in this world, we are always going to fall short when we do not include God's wisdom. And so in all of their seeking, they cannot find who God was. Their human wisdom failed to discover God's power and God's wisdom. But the irony in all of this is that when they accept what they believe is foolish, they find exactly what they were looking for. When they set aside their preconceived notions, when they set aside their philosophies and their worldview, and they accept Jesus for who he is, they find the wisdom that they had been looking for. They find the true power of God available to them. But they couldn't see it because they had these blinders on. But when they take the blinders off, they find what they're looking for. And so what the world thinks is absolutely foolish is actually divinely wise. And what the world considers weakness is where God's power is most clearly visible. Now, Paul goes on to talk about the foolishness of God is wiser than any wisdom of humanity. He's not saying that God is stupid or foolish or dumb. He is saying, it's like, Sarah reminded me, it's like, you know, I've got more strength in my pinky than Charles does back there, which is not true because he could probably throw me across the room. you know, I've got more power in my pinky than my daughter Eve. It's not, you know, that's not literally true, but it is a way of talking. So he's saying that God, you know, in all of our greatness, in all of our intelligence, we are nothing. We amount to nothing. It's like an ant trying to pick up a human. It is impossible. He says the same thing about God's strength, that he's got more, in the weakest part of who he is stronger than all of our might combined. In other words, we are nothing compared to God. And so the foolish cross is perfect wisdom because it shows us the greatness of God, and it shows us how small we are. And so this is how the foolish act of God of sending Jesus shows his greatness. Now, he decided before he created the universe what he was going to have to do. And so he decided beforehand that he was going to send Jesus. Now, if he could see in the future and plan before he creates everything what's going to happen, that's pretty great. And then he makes plans and promises throughout human history, and he does it and he fulfills them with great precision. He moves world leaders and world events around on this giant chessboard, and he orchestrates the perfect chessmate against sin. And he rescues and he calls individual people from among millions and billions in order to make his plan come to pass. And then this great hero of humankind hands himself over to wicked men to show what true sacrifice looks like. And he uses a humiliating, torturous death to show the depth of his love and his grace. He chooses fishermen, a despised tax collector, a known murderer, to turn the world upside down by the proclamation of the gospel. And then you look at the next verses that happen in verses 26 through 31. He sees that God has a tendency throughout history to pick what the world thinks is stupid and dumb and weak in order to change the world. The losers, the wannabes, the stutterers, the doubters, the introverts, the young, the old, the people that the world writes off, that God uses them to turn the world over as a way of showing his great power and wisdom in this world. And so the world might look at us and they might think that we are dumb, that we are stupid, that we are foolish, that we are simpletons, that we are ignorant, that we are bigoted or whatever, because we follow Jesus. But we know that not only the message of the cross, but we know all the teachings of Jesus are true wisdom that help us to learn to live the way that God wants us to live. The wisdom of God gives us new life in this earthly body, and it gives us new life in the life to come. That is something that the world cannot give us. And so just like the apostles faced, just like Jesus faced, the world might look at us, and they might call us names, they might ridicule us. So don't get down and discouraged. Remember that you have and you are experiencing God's power in your life. That you are experiencing wisdom beyond compare. You are experiencing power beyond all human limitations. And if you doubt what God can do in your life or what God can do through your life, remember that God, what God has done throughout history, what He has done through the church, how He has used the weak and the doubting and the foolish to do His will in this earth. So this morning, I hope that we have seen that what the world considers foolish, God considers wise and powerful. And that is the testimony of the Son, Jesus. And so I know we've covered a lot, but there are a couple of things that I want us to take away this morning. The first one is that God is the source of true wisdom and power. It doesn't come from our minds, our imaginations, or our philosophies, because we ourselves are weak and limited. And the second thing is, don't take it personally when the world belittles or makes fun of Christians, or they insult us. It has been happening ever since the church began. It happened to Jesus, and Jesus promised, if the world hates me, it's going to hate you. They're going to belittle you. They're going to torture you. So don't take it personally. Know that it is because you follow God. So the world won't understand the wisdom that comes from God. They're not going to understand the wisdom of the gospel. They're not going to understand the wisdom of a life totally and completely devoted to God. And that's okay. We also understand that we don't have to change to or add to the wisdom of God, because it is perfect in and of itself. We don't have to change it in order to be acceptable to the world, because all that matters is that we are acceptable to God. And God accomplished that by sending Jesus on the cross to take away our sins, so that we would be holy and pleasing in His sight as we are covered in the blood of Jesus. And so if you are a follower of Jesus, don't worry about what those on the outside think of you. If you are a follower of Christ, if you have been cleansed of your sins, if you have a new hope, a new home with God for eternity, all that matters is that you are accepted by God.